Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring. Proudly made in the USA.
Classic Car or Muscle Car? We want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Autorestomod, Jeff talks trash, Larry says no to soda, and they discuss ways to strip. Oh, a car.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-Day Only Mega Sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All right, folks, this week we've got Larry back in the shop because Larry and I wanted to talk about different blasting techniques that you can do to your car, not to blow the car up, because let's face it, you probably don't want to blow your car up.
I have one I'd like to blow it.
We won't talk about that car. All right, so Larry, what do you think about the different methods of blasting?
Well, before we get into the different methods of blasting and paint stripping in general, everybody needs to understand, not every vehicle needs to be stripped.
Right, because we've actually determined that about 65-70% of this wagon doesn't need to be
That's
stripped.
That's correct. Yeah.
How many people do you think actually go in and strip cars then, in the classic car sense, that actually really probably don't need to have the entire paint job taken off?
Well, I'm sure that there's quite a bit done. There needs to be a little bit of homework done first. If a vehicle, new or old, has a really good sound foundation to begin with, don't strip it. No sense in causing yourself extra work that's going to prolong your project.
Right, because on the wagon, again, we've got, you can see some checkering in some places on the car where they put a lacquer paint on top of the old enamel.
And it's just places where it's been spotted in. And when this car was damaged and painted, that was what was the commonplace repair process.
The less expensive repair process, probably. Now, we've used a tool. I saw the tool you're using. What kind of tool is that?
That is a tool for actually measuring. It's an electronic tool to measure the thickness of the material. Keep in mind, so if it's got filler, excessive primer, anything, it's taken into account for all of that.
Now, that tool, obviously, is probably not one that your average enthusiast is
That's
not going to get their hands on.
But if you have a question on your vehicle and you want somebody to measure it, you can normally go to one of your local paint distributors in your area, and their tech rep or somebody should be around to be able to get a someone to come over with a mill gauge and actually read it for them.
Now, what's a good mill reading? I mean, what should a guy expect for a mill reading on a paint job?
Being that we know this one has mostly original paint, and I verified it with the gauge, is usually that 5 to 6 mil thickness range, and paint is registered by mil thickness. Now keep in mind, 1 mil is the thickness of the cellophane of a cigarette pack.
Right.
Okay, so that's very thin.
Very thin.
Okay, so if you're measuring something and it's showing 15, there's a good chance it's been painted 3 or 4 times or has an excessive amount of primer. At that point, you may want to consider, even if it looks sound, you may want to consider stripping it.
Okay. Speaking of stripping, what about soda? I have my opinion on soda at this point with the 67.
Right.
But what do you think about soda? I mean, what are some of the pros and cons that a guy can run into, say, doing it? Because we've got a soda pot right here in front of us. And this is but you can use it for sandblasting and all as well.
Sure.
But that's what I bought this one for, was to soda blast the 67. I had horrible personal results to the point that I actually finally took it to a soda blasting shop.
Right.
And had it finished up, because I used my standard 6-horsepower compressor, was not enough.
That's correct.
And so I had to use I would think you'd need a commercial for it.
You do.
So that's one thing that keeps a DIY guy possibly out of the fight with that.
Correct. Well, what happens is the particles are so fine, it takes a really long time. So a commercial system uses a large volume of material, a whole lot more than you're going to be able to get out of this.
Right.
So whether it's any type of media, whether it's plastic, black beauty, or soda, anything, any of these use large volume of material with low pressure. That's why you don't go and sandblast something, is because it is going to have small volume, large pressure.
So one of the other things I think we ran into with it with using this was just the amount of volume of material that was used and how to dispose of it.
That's correct, because it goes everywhere.
It gets everywhere. We did this over at my uncle's place a while back.
He appreciated it, didn't he?
Oh, he loved me after that.
Yeah.
anyway, we did this over at his place well before we started doing the video work, and I still have 5-gallon buckets full of used soda that are sitting around here in the shop.
Right.
It is a lot of material, and even if you use a water system with it, where I've seen guys do soda with water mix to keep the dust down, it's still...
Well, to me, an issue that you have is just the cleanup afterward. Different companies have advertised it in different ways. Some would you have something blasted and they tell you just to sand over it and go with it, epoxy it, whatever. Wrong information. The metal has to be neutralized. I've heard everything from soap and water to vinegar. Scrubbing it with vinegar and a Scotch-Brite, and then having to wash it. So there's that fear of washing it with water on top of this raw metal.
And that's actually what I did. Now, I did a hot water method, which is, you know, markedly unpleasant if you have hot enough water. What you really want hot, because what you're trying to do is to get the water to evaporate off the finish as quickly as you possibly can. But in some respects, I see that as kind of being counterproductive to the whole process of trying to get it cleaned down to bare metal, because then you're introducing oxidation back into the system because you've stripped the metal with the soda.
But keep in mind, even if you strip it with a grinder, before you put epoxy or anything on it to seal it, it still needs to be sanded back over immediately before putting the primer on, because bare metal, no matter how it is stripped, will start oxidizing within really, you know, like 5 to 7 minutes.
Yeah, and you know, there's a couple of other things that I don't think soda is a bad method.
No.
I think with correct preparation, correct location, with the correct materials, as far as a good industrial compressor, you can have a really good outcome with it.
It's not aggressive enough to take out any large portions of body filler, anything like that. So basically all you're doing with it is skimming the paint and primer off of it.
And in some respects, that may not be a bad thing, because it'll give you a chance to actually look at... That's one of the reasons I kind of like the idea of soda. Because if you're doing a much more aggressive media, the soda has the advantage of it's very fine, as you said. You're going to take the paint and the primer off, and if you have a rust hole there, you're not going to explode that rust hole with the soda like you would with a bigger media or a heavier media.
Right.
Even the plastic medias can sometimes go in and expand those
a
lot more than you want them to. Not that you don't want to take that out, but there's no point in doing more damage than you already have done.
That's right.
So I think soda does have an advantage in that. But one of the things I ran into with the 67 was the undercarriage. Whenever we blasted it, I didn't even consider it. I didn't clean the undercarriage like I cleaned the top side. And the soda... Had I been leaving the original brake lines in the car, the soda ate, not ate, but it's got a crustiness,
etched
it's etched the metal. I guess that's one of the problems with soda in a way, is that it does etch the metal.
Sure.
All of the things underneath the car that were anodized or plated, those kind of platings, all of them were corroded and still are. I mean, I've gone in and fixed all of it, but boy, that's a hassle to have to go back in and do that.
Sure.
Unless you're taking the entire car apart after you soda blast it.
Right.
So, what do you think? I mean, soda as a method is just a bottom line for everybody. What do you think of soda as a method?
It's not my favorite.
Okay.
Even if you're not doing it yourself, if you're taking it to a company to have it done, my experience was in the past, most of these guys charge by hourly rate. That's the way they have to, because some cars are going to be rougher than others. Well, if this is slower, then it's going to cost you more than a faster process. And they are faster processes. So you're kind of hurting yourself.
Sure. And it's like we said, this really isn't a DIY process.
Not really.
I mean, because once you rent the compressor and you buy the media, you buy the pot to do it, although the pot can be used in other ways,
yes,
you're still going to probably almost have as much money as if you took it to a professional shop and had them do it.
That's true.
Okay. Well, I guess we're going to move on to the next thing. We'll get this stuff out of here, and Larry and I are going to talk then about plastic media. Woo! Okay, so we've swept the soda out of the way. It's gone. Plastic media.
Yes.
The next subject matter, because that's the next most popular, in my opinion, from what I hear from guys, one of the next most popular ways of reducing the paint on the car.
Which would be my absolute favorite.
Really?
It is. And there again depends upon budget and
sure.
size of job.
So what makes plastic media better to you than soda?
It doesn't have to be neutralized. That'd be the biggest issue.
Yes.
Okay. Still not something that you're going to do it yourself at home, guys. You're going to be carrying your parts somewhere to have this done.
Right.
Difference being the size of the particle being used and the volume, sheer volume of it cuts a little quicker than what you're going to get out of soda.
Okay.
Okay. Try to tell people not to use sand on their car. And sand is not the enemy.
No.
Okay. It's the way that it's used. Most sandblasters are set up so that they actually use a small volume and use a lot of pressure.
Right.
And they're running, to make it function, you're talking 80 to 100 pounds of pressure. And that's going to warp the vehicle up.
Sure.
It's good on a rusty spot.
Yeah, that's interesting. But one of the bad things I think about plastic media, in my experience, we did a Camaro back when I was still in the magazine business. And I helped working on the Camaro. And even after it had come back from paint, we were still getting plastic media
that's
showering
correct.
Out of the scuppers from the doors when we would shut the doors. So that tells me that it can be a real danger when you're painting your car.
It is. It
with
is.
Fly
it,
material.
Sand would be the same way. There's all of those types of products. There's little issues whichever way you decide to go.
So you say that's a consistent problem then with any of them?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
We didn't...
Now keep in mind, when you go to the blaster, you have options. You don't have to have the door jams blasted, that kind of thing. You could take a car like the one behind us, do a little bit of detrimming and take it and have it just the outside blasted. And what they'll do is they'll take some 2-inch foam tape and cover the door jam openings.
Right.
And around the hood and all, and they'll blast everything up to the tape. When you get it back, the only thing that's skin off of it is the outside, and you'll have to sand off that 2-inch strip of paint.
You might be able to just go in and feather sand some of these areas,
right.
maybe, you know, prime it and
if
shoot
If you've
it.
Got the older car that's had a rough life and it's got 3 or 4 different colors on it and it's got abundance of paint built up in the jams and under the deck lid and all that stuff, then yeah, you'll want to strip all that. But if it's a fairly clean, all original underneath, and it's just had a few paint jobs on the outside, you just strip just the outside.
Right.
Okay.
So, plastic media, not DIYable. Same
not
problem.
Really.
Yeah, same problem we had with the soda. The same issues
yeah.
with low pressure,
yeah.
high volume.
They're using about 30 pounds of pressure, large hose, and they'll actually set it up in what looks like an old-style paint booth. And it'll have a big hopper. And they'll try to recycle as much of that as they can. So they'll take a shovel and they'll put it back in
and it still
and
takes a
it.
Ton of media even it with
it takes
with
a
the
bunch
plastic.
Of it.
So
it does.
Yeah, so that's still another problem. Cleanup would still be an issue and all that because you're gonna still have
yeah.
all those problems with
it. It leaves a really nice finish on the metal and fiberglass.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, you can do a nice job on fiberglass, but what you'll have to do is basically sand it. And it'll leave a little bit of a coating just from the material itself. You'll take a DA sander with some 180, sand over it, clean it with some metal prep, and put epoxy primer on it, and it looks great.
Bada bing, bada boom.
Yeah. The only problem that you're going to run into, as with many of the others that are soft enough to not hurt the metal, won't really do much for rust. What you're going to run into is some of us have these old cars, and you may have something that has really deep pits in it where it's been sitting out in the field for 80 years.
Right.
You can take the top layer off and you still can't get down into the pits. Your blasting supply company is going to have something like, it's not sand, but it's something they'll call Black Beauty. And it's there again, kind of a serrated edge, harder bead than what a plastic bead would be. It'll actually get in to those areas and try to get all that rust out of the deep pits and take care of the rust areas. So if you have a clean vehicle other than a few spots, you will talk it over with your blast guy. He'll media blast whatever is necessary, and then he'll go back and use the Black Beauty on the really rusty areas.
Okay. We already know what your favorite is. I don't have a favorite at this point because, mm-hmm. like I said before, I've had so many bad experiences
sure.
with every one of the types of blasting, which is one of the reasons I mm-hmm. wanted to do this,
yeah.
is to go over what's available and tell guys, you know, we're not saying that any one of these things is the answer
sure.
for them, but to give them some ways to look at it.
That's right.
All right, so let's pull that one out and go on to our next one.
Okay.
All right. Okay, next up on the list is water glass blasting, which I haven't had any experience with this one.
I haven't either.
But I can see where it could run into some of the same problems that we were talking about with soda, because you're using a water immediately in the process.
Correct.
So I would kind of wonder about that from the rust problem of if you're going from the back of the car to the front of the car, the amount of time it's going to take to get all that done, although it seems like with it being a glass, a reclaimed glass, it would move pretty quickly.
You would think.
You would think, because the media is pretty aggressive, mm-hmm. I would guess. Mm-hmm. Plus, the water would keep the media cool when it's hitting the metal. It's not heating the metal up.
One of the things to consider also is using it with water. If that's, I can't imagine that's something you're going to do out in the parking lot or in the driveway.
I don't know. I've seen some good reports on this from some of the guys that actually do professional blasting. Mm-hmm. I've read some of the stuff on some of the forums. They really seem to like the process. But again, falling back to, it is more of a professional line thing.
Yes.
You are going to have a commercial compressor to do it. You have to have their pot system to do
yep.
it. So this is not something that you're going to go out and just buy a pot like you would with the soda stuff and start working on
Correct.
It yourself. You're going to have to buy some expensive equipment with this water/glass. Now,
there's also something new out.
What's that?
That's dry ice blasting. I've seen some videos. Looks pretty neat. Have no idea of the expense.
I would kind of wonder about that, because dry ice isn't exactly the cheapest stuff in
right.
the world to buy. The other thing I would wonder about is, does it still fall into the same problem that we were talking about with water issue? And you would want to look at, I would think, the costing on it is like, what is the difference? Because a lot of these places probably offer multiple styles.
Right.
You would want to find out what's their hourly mm-hmm. rate on dry ice as opposed to the glass water process, soda, or media.
That's right.
I would think I would want to do that. If I were going to take it to a pro shop, which is what we're talking about with this, those are things you would need to do. Now,
and all of this is really, everything we've talked about so far is really, really geared more to the full restoration car.
Right.
It's more than just your average, I'm going to fix this nice car up and just paint it.
Anyway, so that's those. Now we're going to move over. We're going to bring in a couple of props, because we actually have props for this one.
Yep.
We're going to bring in some chemical stripping stuff to show the guys one of the oldest methods that I know of for stripping a classic car.
Yes.
So let's pull our props in here and we'll show them that stuff.
Let's do okay? it.
What are you doing?
I'm getting a lap dance by a stripper.
We had done so well. We had looked so professional up until then.
I'm sorry.
You're not sorry.
No, not really.
Okay, so strippers.
You know it.
What more can we say?
Yeah.
So chemical stripping is probably one of the oldest, most tried and true methods that slowly but surely the federal government is trying to get rid of.
Yes, they are.
Because you said even on the West Coast that they are real natty about that. They don't.
It is getting like that here.
Really?
Yes.
Even in the Great South, where people have been redneck stripping cars for Lord only knows how long.
Yes.
Now, what's going on? Why is chemical stripper becoming such an issue?
It's really not to do with the stripper itself. It's how it's disposed of.
Ah.
Because this has to be washed off of the vehicle.
Right.
Okay. Water. So the old way was right out in the front of the shop or in the driveway, and you slop it on there, you let it bubble up, you scrape it off, you do all your work, and it's piling up on the concrete. You take the water hose and wash the car, and it all goes down into the sewer drain.
So it's really about how people dispose of it, not necessarily
the disposal,
process.
Not the process, it's the disposal.
Now, what about some of the, because I know that there are some low VOC strippers available, but they...
It's kind of like low VOC carburetor cleaner. It just kind of laughs at it.
It's like, what is that?
Yeah. This is some pretty mean stuff.
Yeah, that I know that stuff, the clean strip has usually been really good for that kind of thing.
Very good product. It does need to be used in a warm temperature.
Yeah, you're not going to strip on a day like we've got. It's like in the 50s out there right now, and that's not a good time. You want it to be as...
It needs to be hot.
So you need to be miserable when you're doing chemical stripping.
Pretty well. Well, you're going to be anyway, because you're going to be wearing a respirator, not a dust mask.
No.
A respirator. Chemical cartridge respirator. You're going to have, hopefully, a suit on and some gloves. Mini gloves. And this will eat up the gloves.
Yeah, over the course of doing the stripping, you're going to probably change gloves out several times in order to go through it.
This will actually mess up glass, chrome. But anyway, works very well. It's very effective, but it's god-awful messy. Now, keep in mind, there are certain ways to do this stuff that makes it a little quicker, like spreading it out with a brush and then taking some plastic and covering it up.
I've also heard some guys going in and using like an 80 or a 60 grit DA on the just to basically
open
the finish up so that it moves
so
quicker.
Yes, so it penetrate better.
Right.
Right.
So chemical, one of the oldest methods, kind of going out of favor because of the disposal issues
with
it.
That's correct. A body shop, even here in the South, whenever they're doing their EPA testing, has to account for how much of this they use. That's why very few body shops have this in their supply cabinet now.
But, in all fairness, this is a DIY product.
It is, without a doubt.
So a guy could go in, if he wanted to strip his car with chemical strippers,
he can
do that.
He can. Right. Because EPA says that the do-it-yourself guy can legally go buy material and paint one car a year.
I did not know that. So he can also go down, because you can buy the aircraft stripper down at Lowe's and home improvement centers all over the United States.
That's right. So for the shops that are using it, they're having to cover the floor in plastic.
Now, I would recommend doing that even if you're doing it on your own.
That's right. That's right. And then basically, before they wash it all off the car, as you're scraping, it's falling on the ground, and all this massive buildup of paint, you let it fall onto the plastic, and then you wrap it all up in it, encase itself.
Right.
But there are ways to have to be disposing of that, just as you dispose of used paint, lacquer thinner, things of that nature.
Well, okay, that's our one DIY method, and we're going to go ahead and move on here in a second. I'm going to go grab some sandpaper, and we're going to talk about the next DIY method, which is physical removal.
Yes.
All right.
Yay.
Let me go get it. All right, another old method. Just plain old hard work with 40 grit sandpaper on a disc.
Woo-wee.
But with this...
That'll take a while.
It's going to be there all day. More than all day. You'll be there for days and days. And you're going to use a lot of material doing it, I would imagine. Mm-hmm. Now, you've got the big mamma jamma there.
8 inches of power.
Dun, dun, dun.
Okay. You can get this in a variety of grits.
Is this the one that you use for your buffing, or do you have a different?
This is the machine that I use for my buffing. Totally different pad.
Yeah, totally different pad, because... I see it's an aerated pad.
Mm-hmm. But you also notice it's a little soft, but it's still firm.
Right.
Okay. You want a little bit of give. You don't want a really, really hard back pad, because you're going to get up into these little body rolls and stuff, and you don't want to gouge it up.
Right. And with a situation like what you've got going on with this, what do you recommend for grit on the paper?
If it is, if it's not super thick, if it's in pretty decent shape, if you can get by with 80 grit, you're better off.
Yeah, because you're not going to start gouging up the metal as bad with 80 grit.
Yeah, 80 grit won't be bad. Yeah,
I've seen guys take 40 and do it, and 40 is terrible.
You can zip it off with 80. If you start with 80 and you get some car, and it's what you're going to find when you get digging into some of these cars. If it's got a lot of lacquer paint, a lot of lacquer primer, and a lot of buildup of material, you may have it'll start gumming up the 80 grit. You may have to go to 40, but if you can do it with 80, you got less scratch in the metal.
Yeah, and the problem with that is when you start doing an 8-inch 80 grit pad,
yeah,
that's going to get expensive pretty quick compared to
it is
some
it
of the
is,
other processes.
But you can buy a box of 80 or a box of 40 and normally do the entire car.
Really? So what's a box? I mean, a box is how many?
Well, depending on which brand you get, they're different.
Let's just give a like
so
a round
if you
number.
Do a 3M or a Norton or something, you're talking. You're tall, you know, 20 sheets, 25 sheets.
Okay, so that's not too bad then. 20 sheets is not bad at all to do a whole car.
No.
But there are places, like I said, there are places I think this applies very, very well in what we do with these old cars.
I'm working on one right now where I've used this same machine with 40 grit to zip all of the paint and existing filler off of this front end that has lacquer primer, lacquer paint. It's real gummy. It's got gobs of filler underneath. And this was my best option.
So you want a good quality paper.
You want a good paper.
Because there is a difference in that, too, when you're doing a mechanical removal method.
That's right.
Your papers, some of them clean better as they're sanding than others do. So that's going to be an issue as well. You want to make sure you don't cheapen out and buy the, you know, Acme brand paper.
Correct.
You want to buy the good stuff if you're going to do it.
So you'll want to make sure that you don't put this on some high-speed grinder. You'll want to put it on your buffer that you can control the speed. You want to be around 2,000 RPM. You don't really not need to go any more than that. So that makes it a lot more controllable.
All right. Well, that's mechanical. But let's do this. We've gotten all this boiled down for these guys. Let's go and take a look at the 69 wagon because we're a mixed media on this car. We've already talked about it a little bit. But I want to show the guys what we've been discussing, the fact that some places we're going to leave alone, we're going to probably sand some areas, we're going to do some chemical stripping, and those areas that we want to do that with.
Sure.
Right? So let's take a look at it. Okay, Larry, so we're going to talk about what we've got going on with our wagon. Now, you've already said you think that the front end on this car, pretty much outside, is all lacquer.
Yes.
Because I can see lacquer pop on it, it just looks like a lacquer paint job. But that's not the case on the whole car.
Correct.
So what are we going to do here? What would you recommend doing with this car if you were going to strip this thing to get it ready for paint? I mean, I know we're not going to strip most of the back of the car, but what about the lacquer front fenders and all that?
If it was up to me, I would probably take the fenders and the hood and have media plastic. If I was something I just wanted to do at home, I would take 80 grit on my buffer with the thick pad, and I'd zip all of it off the face of it. And then I'd come in and probably chemical strip inside of here, or I would use low pressure on a sandblaster and cover all this up and only shoot inside of here.
Now, what would you use to cover up the fender with if you're going to do the sandblasting technique?
I would get several layers of tape along the edge here, and I would get like an old blanket or something, something to absorb some impact.
Right. Okay. Good idea. Now, we've got here on the door where they faded in with the lacquer on top of the enamel. So what would you do? Because obviously we want to keep this part of the door is the original finish here.
Right.
This part is probably to about right there is lacquer. So what do we need to do in order to get this work down? I know we don't want to go in and mess with this too much.
We would probably just take the DA with some 180 and work it down from here and just cut all that off.
And just feather edge this.
And feather edge it into here. This being the original enamel finish will feather really well.
Right.
Okay. Now keep in mind, this being a Ford would have had enamel. If this was a 69 GM car and it was original paint, it would be lacquer and it would all really need to come off because the lacquer will always get problems. That's correct.
So that is one advantage, I guess, to having a Ford at this point.
One of the only.
Come on around the car. Let's talk about the rest of this stuff. Okay, Larry, so we've got another thing we wanted to talk about. So we know that the front of the car has all been done in lacquer.
Yes.
So you recommend, as we said on the fender, going in and getting this done in a media blast. Now, one of the things I thought about doing with this is if you were going to do it mechanically or with a stripper like we were talking about, I figure on this it would probably be a good use stripper on that. Use your strippers wherever you can. Because I think chemical stripper would be better here, right?
Yes.
Because you got these little grills that you're going to have to
get. Because you'll never be able to sand in there to get all that out.
No, and you do want to do that because they went in and did it with lacquer.
That's right.
Because you want to get all the lacquer off before you go back in with your enamel paints. So I'm going to do that, and then the rest of the car we're going to pretty much leave alone and just sand, block sand it
to find out what's wrong with it, and then strip the paint off of the areas where the bodywork's going to be.
Basically like you would do a new car.
Just like you do a new car.
Because a new car, you're not going to go in and refinish an entire panel. You're going to go in and work the little area you need to work.
That's correct.
So that's what we're going to do on this one. So,
I will say, we do know Fords came with enamels, and GM came with lacquer. If you have another brand, research to find out what kind of paint it is. If you look at old Porsches, things like that, they'll have a tag under the hood that'll say like Herbert's.
Mm-hmm.
And Herbert's is going to be an enamel. Basically, it would have been a urethane
right.
from back in the day, different things. So there's a wide variety of different products. So it just depends on where it was made.
Right, and that's a good point because there's no way to know. And the other thing you might want to mm-hmm. do is if you have a car and you're unsure about it, you can test the paint, the old paint, to figure out whether it's lacquer or enamel, right? I mean,
Pretty well. You could actually take a rag with lacquer thinner, a good gray lacquer thinner, and just lay it up here and let it set for a little while, and you'll soften that paint up and be able to wipe it off. That's the reason that the lacquer has to come off. The enamel finish is really not going to hurt the enamel finish.
Okay.
Okay, you may soften it enough to make it fingernail. Lacquer is actually going to soften up to actually take it off the car.
Okay. Well, so now all we have to do is, I guess, do it. But we're not going to do that right now. We've got a couple other things we need to do on the car. But some little bodywork things, some rust repairs. But just leave it, patina.
Yeah.
That's the hot new thing now anyway.
That's what they tell me.
Yeah, like they want the patina. And I'm like, if it was all original paint, I would probably say that's not a bad idea. But that thing on the hood, that bugs me. That really bugs
me. That's the only thing that bugs you?
No, not really, but that's the big thing. When I'm looking out the windshield, I can see that. Well, Larry, man, I appreciate you coming in today and talking with us about this because you have a lot more professional experience with this kind of stuff than I do. Although, I'm getting to the point now with all the things I've had stripped, I know pretty much what I do and don't like.
Oh, yeah.
We could have brought yours in, but you didn't bring it today, so I don't know why.
It's in timeout.
It's in wheel timeout, mm-hmm. which is another episode we've got coming up that we're going to do because of the things you run into with your car.
Yes.
We're going to really do an episode on talking about getting your wheels and offsets on rear axles and all that kind of stuff. We ran into a lot of stuff setting up the wheels on that car.
I just hope those new ones fit.
I do too because you spent a
lot of
effort.
I don't really pay for them.
All right, folks, that's our show for this week. Be sure to come back and watch the next time on Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks. So you sure you don't want to get started now?
I'm real sure.
Yeah.